are listening to The Life of Jesus Christ in a Year, from the visions of Anne Catherine Emmerich from TAN. I'm Father Edward Looney, and each day I will be reading and offering commentary to guide you through Anne Catherine Emmerich's magnificent mystical revelations. In addition to listening, you can follow along with the four-volume hardcover set of The Life of Jesus Christ and Biblical Revelations available from TAN. Before we get to today's reading, let us ask the intercession of our venerable author. O blessed Anne Catherine Emmerich, devout and pious follower of Christ, who patiently endured the frailty of this mortal condition, who humbly received the honorable marks of Christ Jesus on your hands, feet, side, head, and chest, the marks which you were blessed by the Lord to witness for yourself in his own sufferings, we graciously ask for your intercession with God, that we sinners may be forgiven of our sins and be drawn more completely into spiritual communion with Christ, our Lord and Savior. We ask this in the name of the most holy Lamb of God, and through the intercession of Holy Mary, our Mother. Amen. Today is day number 94. And in this episode, we'll continue reading from Volume 2. Today, we begin a new section, from the close of the first Pasch to the conversion of the Samaritan woman at Jacob's well. Number 1. The Letter of King Abgarus. From Bethania, where Jesus had for some time remained in concealment, he went to the place of baptism near Ono. The arrangements were still in good order, owing to the care of its custodians. The disciples gathered around Jesus, and crowds of people came streaming in. As Jesus was teaching before the multitude, part of whom were standing, others sitting on wooden platforms in a circle around him, a stranger approached, mounted on a camel. He was followed by 6 attendants who rode on mules. They halted at the tents, some distance from the place of instruction. It was an embassy from King Abgarus, who was sick and who had sent presents to Jesus with a letter in which he implored him to come to Edessa to cure him. He had had an eruption that had settled in his feet and rendered him lame. Travelers returning to their homes had told him about Jesus and his miracles, of the testimony of John, and the wrath of the Jews at the last Paschal solemnity, all which had excited in him a great longing to be cured by Jesus. The young man commissioned to bear the king's letter to Jesus was an artist, and he had received commands to bring back Jesus' portrait if he would not come himself. I saw him vainly trying to reach Jesus. He pressed sometimes here, sometimes there through the crowd, both to hear the instruction and to paint Jesus's likeness. Then Jesus bade one of the disciples to make room for the man that was going around, people unable to push his way to the front. And he pointed out a platform nearby to which he should be conducted. The disciple brought the envoy forward and placed him and his attendants where they could see and hear. They had with them gifts of woven stuffs, thin plates of gold, and very beautiful lambs. The envoy, overjoyed at being able at last to see Jesus at once, produced his drawing materials, rested his tablet on his knee, regarded Jesus with great admiration and attention, and set to work. The tablet before him was white as if made of wax. He began by sketching with a pencil the outlines of Jesus' head and beard. Then it looked as if he spread over his work a layer of wax in which to receive the impression of the sketch. After that, he resumed his sketching, touched again and again with his pencil, again took the impression, and so continued, but without ever perfecting his work. As often as he glanced at Jesus, he seemed lost in amazement at the countenance he beheld, and was forced to begin anew. Luke did not paint in exactly this way. He used a brush also. The picture this man was producing appeared to me to be somewhat in relief. One could trace it by the touch. Jesus continued his discourse a while longer, and then sent the disciple to say to the envoy that he might now approach and deliver his message. The envoy came down from the platform, whereon he was sitting, followed by his attendants with the presents and lambs. His doublet was short, almost like those of the three kings, and he wore no mantle. The picture at which he had been working was hanging by a strap on his left arm. It was like a shield in the form of a heart. In the right hand, he held the king's letter. Casting himself on his knees before Jesus, he bowed low, as did also his attendants, and said, "Thy slave is the servant of Abgarus, king of Edessa. He is sick. He sends this letter and prays thee to accept these gifts from him." Then the slaves approached with the presents. Jesus replied to the envoy that the good intentions of his master were pleasing to him, and he commanded the disciples to take the gifts and distribute them among the poorest of the assembled crowd. Then he unfolded the letter and read it. I do not remember all that was in it, but only that the king referred to Jesus' power to raise the dead and begged him to come and cure him. The part of the letter containing the writing was stiff, the envelope pliable, as if of some kind of stuff, either leather or silk. I saw, too, that it was bound by a string. When Jesus had read the letter, he turned the other side of the stiff part and, drawing from his robe, a coarse pencil, out of which he pushed something. He wrote several words in tolerably large characters, and then folded it again. After that, he called for some water, bathed his face, pressed the soft stuff in which the letter had been folded to his sacred countenance, and returned it to the envoy. The latter applied it to the picture he had vainly tried to perfect, when, behold, the likeness instantly became a facsimile of the original. The artist was filled with delight. He turned the picture, which was hanging by a strap, toward the spectators, cast himself at Jesus' feet, arose, and took leave immediately. But some of his servants remained behind and followed Jesus, who, after this instruction, crossed the Jordan of the second place of baptism, which John had abandoned. There, these new followers were baptized. I saw the envoy on his way home, passing a night outside a city near which were long stone buildings, like brick kilns. Very early the next morning, some of the workmen hurried to the spot, because they had seen there a bright light, like a fire. Something remarkable then took place in connection with the picture, and a great crowd of people gathered on the spot. The artist exhibited to them his picture, as well as a cloth with which Jesus had dried his face, and which, too, had received the imprint of his features. Abgarus came some distance through the gardens to meet his envoy. He was indescribably touched at Jesus' letter and the sight of his picture. He immediately amended his life and dismissed the numerous concubines with whom he had sinned. I saw again that after the death of Abgarus's son, in the reign of a wicked successor, the portrait of Jesus, which had been publicly exposed, was concealed by a pious bishop. He placed it in a niche, a burning lamp before it, and walled up the aperture. After a long time, the picture was discovered, and then it was found that the stone that concealed it from sight also bore its imprint. This concludes our reading today. And now we reflect on what we have just listened to, what we have just read. Today is one of those interesting readings that we have from Anne Catherine Emmerich. It's one that, as I was recording, I pressed pause and I did a little research before I came back, resuming the recording, because I thought it was important to confirm. Maybe in our day and age, we would call this fact check. I wanted to fact check about King Abgarus, and to see if he was real, if he lived during the time of Jesus, all of these facts, not because I doubted Anne Catherine Emmerich, but because, again, something that I've said over and over in our recordings and readings is that when we have facts like this, it historically authenticates everything, in a sense. Anne Catherine Emmerich, would she have had knowledge of Abgarus? I don't know. But yet she has this vision, and she sees the king sending an envoy, the king who is ill, the king who needs healing. Well, I am able to confirm, Abgar V, he was king. He died in the year 50 AD, which means he would have reigned probably during the time of Jesus. He was alive during this time of ministry. And just a simple Google search, you know, yields the legend of King Abgar, the legend of King Abgar, letters between the Lord Jesus and King Abgar V. That's all I see without clicking further. I also see Britannica, the Abgar legend, King of Edessa, miraculous image. So what Anne Catherine Emmerich is writing about, there are encyclopedias. Britannica, the Catholic Encyclopedia on New Advent, even has an entry, The Legend of Abgar. Is the legend true? The National Catholic Register writes. Did Jesus write a letter to King Abgar? I don't know about you, but today's the first day I heard of King Abgar. It amazes me that someone at National Catholic Register back in 2016 chose to write this article. I'm going to click on it here. You're getting a live play-by-play. I just want to see who the author is. Thomas L. McDonald. But you wonder then, how did Thomas McDonald become aware of it? Did he become aware because of Anne Catherine Emmerich? Is there some other contributing factor to this author, for example, their interest in spotlighting it? I think what's impressive here is that you have a king who is curious about Jesus and wants Jesus to come, that this king hears about the miracles and wants Jesus to come and heal him because he himself is experiencing illness. The king sends an envoy, sends an artist who paints this portrait of Jesus. And then Jesus writes a letter back, writes something, allows this portrait to be painted, brings a cloth to his face, and much like the shroud of, not the shroud of Turin, much like the veil of Veronica, the image of Jesus is imprinted. Well, I guess on the Shroud of Turin, the image of Jesus is imprinted as well. But this is a cloth Jesus brings to his face, and his countenance is related onto that piece of cloth. Seems like an impressive account. It's a legend. I hope it's a true legend. It's kind of a beautiful little story. And then we hear that the king, that the king walked out, and then he, I guess you could say, he experienced the grace of healing. That an image of Jesus communicated healing. That the image of Jesus brought that about for King Abgar. What an interesting story, too, that the picture would be hidden during a time of vile reign, of kind of persecution of Christian believers. And then when it was discovered again, the image of Jesus imprinted on the stone. Jesus leaving his mark everywhere in terms of his image being imprinted upon objects. I think it emphasizes for us the value of religious imagery. In my bedroom, I have two religious images, one of the Dormition of Mary. I have it near my bed so as if I fall asleep in death that Our Lady will come to me, just as Jesus came to her in her dormition. I have another image of Our Lady that I bought at an event, at a festival, an Irish image of the Blessed Mother. Just the other day, I was going through a lot of my belongings that are in storage in the basement. A lot of religious images. I need to get better at circulating them and making better use of them. And I found an image from my college seminary, an icon of Christ the Priest that one of the monks had painted for the seminary in which they gave to each of us as alumni. And I picked it up and I said, I'm going to put this in my little house chapel. It's important for us to have images of Jesus, to have images of Mary or the saints. They communicate heavenly realities to us, the reminders of holiness and godliness. King Abgar surely treasured this portrait of Jesus. Maybe King Abgar, I don't know, did he meet Jesus? But if he never met Jesus, he knew what he looked like. He knew his story. And he received grace from the Lord himself. This brings us to a close of our reading and reflection for today. Please be sure to subscribe to the podcast and sign up for email notifications at emmerichpodcast.com and use coupon code ACE25 for 25% off your next order at tanbooks.com. Please share this podcast with others. Share it with your family, text it to your friends, send a message out to your prayer group, let them know you're listening, and encourage them to join you so that you can have holy conversations with them about these writings of Anne Catherine Emmerich. I hope you'll join us next time as we continue meditating on the life of Jesus Christ with the help of Blessed Anne Catherine Emmerich. Until then, may God bless you, and Mary pray for you.